on. Looks kind of formal. And I left my one of my props back here under the seat. Probably wondering what that is. And so that'll keep you on suspense for a while. Really good to be here in Iowa Falls. We don't live too far away from here, over in Union. And we come over here sometimes for some shopping and just to look around and to get into the city, you see. This is city for us. And today I had to drive out around the city. My detour for 65, all of a sudden I realized when I got out east of town a ways that was for the highway, not necessarily Iowa Falls. So we came back in to Iowa Falls. But so good to be here with you. Lydia. I'm going to get it here. Lily. I finally got it. Thank you. Would you mind helping me to pass these out? These are some notes. I told her what a pretty name she has, which it is, and then I forgot it. So good to be here. We have known the Hills for many years. In fact, Pastor Hill and myself were in Bible college together. He was young and I was even older in Bible college. But we pastored together up north here a ways. He was in New Hartford and I was in Green. And he was the secretary for my ordination. So he took notes. He was really good as secretary, taking notes. And so we really appreciate the opportunity to come over and make this available to do today, the preaching. Linda and I do go out, fill pulpits, and present our ministry of SIM, with Seniors in Ministry, which is helping older people and younger people write their life stories. Just that younger people don't have as much story yet. They haven't lived as long. But we are, last week we were in Monticello, Iowa. And that was interesting. We've never been there before until then. They're looking for a pastor over there now, as we are as well in Union. And so I got to fill in over there and see that part of the state. And so it's really good to travel around some and to meet the different people in the churches. That's what I and Linda enjoy so much. I enjoyed today meeting Kathy here because she's up from north here a ways and around close to Dumont. And I said, but do you know the Cruzy, Brian Lynn Cruzy? Yeah, she in fact worked for Dr. Cruzy, a veterinarian, for a while, worked there. And also, I said, well, you know, I married him, you know. She says, yeah, I was there, down in the basement. And that was a huge wedding, and our church there in Green was fairly small, and so we had people everywhere. And I didn't realize till the day that there were people in the basement. Kathy was one of them. But that's what I like about going out and meeting people. It's amazing the connections that we have sometimes with people. And we never realized that, we'd never know that if we hadn't gone and met people and filled in at the churches. Well, today, I'm so glad that took that first song about holiness, because that's what we're going to mainly be looking at today. If you turn to 1 Peter, we'll consider especially an exhortation in the last times or in the hard times. The hard times. Has anyone here ever gone through hard times? Yeah. It may be even now you're going through hard times. In fact, I think our nation is going through hard times right now. We have had that happen before. Of course, our world wars and the Civil War, all the hard times that this nation has had to go through. And today, I think each time, each age is a little different, the trials. And now I think probably one of the biggest trials we've ever had in our nation is our division. And of course, going back to the Civil War was a great division, but today we have one as well. And we really pray for our country, for all of those in authority over us, that we might live a peaceable and a good life, you know, that the government's supposed to look over and help us with and protect us for everything that they are ordained to do. And we're thankful for that today. But we do have a division, and one thing that will bring us together as Christians as much as possible, I think, is this exhortation of holiness. Hard times. This is what they were going through back here in Peter's day. Really hard times. They were being persecuted for their faith. And when they took a stand for their faith, apart from the Jewish tradition or whatever they might have been involved in, even being heathens and being pagans, whatever they came out of and took a stand as a Christian, we find that they would suffer for that. They would be persecuted greatly for that. Well, I think that this exhortation that we find in chapter 1, verse 16, is something that really meant a lot to them back then, and it should mean a lot to us today as well, as we sang about this in our first hymn. And that is verse 16 of chapter 1. We find, because it is written, maybe I should go back up to verse 15, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Well, why? Why should we be holy? Here God gives us that exhortation, or even that command in the sense, imperative, that we be holy like him. Be holy like him. That is quite a thing, isn't it, for us to try to do? Well, in order to understand that, what holiness is, we need to understand that it means set apart. Holiness means to be set apart. And that the Christians that day and today are set apart. Set apart for God. And so if we're set apart for God, we ought to have a little bit of understanding, or as much as we can have, and thankful for Eric teaching our Sunday school lesson this morning. We should have that understanding of God as much as possible and his attributes. But this holiness is one that we especially need to have for a foundation, as he talked about dispensationalism having a foundation. So exhortation to holiness is to build up in holiness, to build up in holiness. And so how are we to be holy? Why? And then we'll look at how. Why holy? Well, start with, God said so. Now, he said that we are to be holy like him. Now, that should be enough, really, hasn't it? God said it, we ought to do it. our Heavenly Father wants us to be holy, like Him, like His Son, and with the power of the Holy Spirit. Because He says so, to be holy, we should do that. We should obey. We should make that a priority in our lives to be holy because God said so. You know, I think about obedience or listening to our Heavenly Father and doing what He says. I think of my earthly father. When I was about 14 years old, I remember my dad had his favorite chair that he sat in. That was his chair. And I was 14, and I remember messing around in the house, and I was pestering him. You know what pestering is? Yeah, I was being a nuisance to him. You know, I was teasing him and fooling around. I don't even know why I was doing it. He was sitting there all relaxed in his chair. And, you know, he said, "Stop it. Stop pestering me. Stop it." You know I didn't. You know what happened? He came up out of that chair. And I didn't realize that my dad could do what he did to me. But he took a hold of me, and my room was upstairs. And he helped me upstairs all the way when I had to stay in my room. But I never realized that he could come alive like that. I was amazed. And so after that, I didn't do that anymore. You know, I realized that he was the boss. He was the father. And, you know, just I think of that when I think of this, is that we shouldn't, you know, we should do what God says. God says to be holy. Well, why? Because He says so. And then because of who He is, what He's like. We should want to be like Him. We see that here back in verses 2, it says, "Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience, sprinkling of blood of Jesus." And so then, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to His abundant mercy, has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So not only should we be like God because He tells us to be like Him, but because of who He is, what He's like. We find that He has brought us into His family. We are His children. He has the knowledge much greater than we do. I don't understand salvation to the point of I understand it on my part, whosoever will, that I need to be saved, I need to respond as a sinner, and call upon the name of the Lord to forgive my sins and be my Savior. I understand I'm a sinner. I understand how my salvation, how it came about through Jesus Christ and His shed blood on the cross and His glorious resurrection. And that's what it's talking about here, actually, is salvation. But it's talking about that actually God had a part in it too, a big part. And I need to accept that I'm His child, that He has made a plan for me. He knew me before I ever knew myself, which is amazing. And that He has a plan and He has a purpose. And He figured it all out in His foreknowledge. And I, like I said, I don't understand all that, but God has done this for us in salvation. So why should we be like God? Because He said so, and why? The fact that He is smarter than we are. He's much bigger. He's bigger than our problems. He's bigger than this earth. I mean, he's bigger. He is so big. God, and he's smart. God is smart. Isn't that something? I mean, he's really smart. If you go on one of these quiz shows, you know, I mean, there'd be no contest. He is smart. And he is God. And we find that because he is holy, he is set apart himself in his holiness, and we are to be set aside, set apart as well, to be holy. He said so. He is in control. He has furnished what we need. He has supplied it through, here it says, the obedience and the sprinkling of blood of Jesus Christ. We know that he has sent his son, Jesus, to pay the price on the cross, to shed his precious blood for our sins, and to raise from the dead and promise to come again. So we find not only then did he say so, why we should be holy, but also because he is holy, because he is smart, because he's smarter than we are, and he is merciful, verse 3. We see that there has begotten us again to a living hope. Before that, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his abundant mercy. Mercy is not getting what we deserve. He has had mercy on us. And even what we deserve is hell. What we deserve is separation. But here in this book, Peter is trying to instill in the persecuted Christians that they are special. They have God's mercy. And it's a wonderful thing to know that God loves us, and that his mercy and his love and his grace is so free in our lives and so present. So we should want to be like God because of the way he is. He says so, yes, but he is knowledgeable, he's smart, he's merciful, and he's sure. You know, I mean, he is a sure thing. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is always the same. Now, that's not always true of us, is it? Sometimes we get sick. Sometimes we get downhearted. Sometimes we get wore out. Sometimes so many things can happen to us in this body. But we find God is always the same. He's never sick, or he's never unavailable. He's always the same. And that's wonderful to know, because we can't exactly be like God in that sense, but we can try to always be the same, and especially as we think spiritually, not necessarily physically, but spiritually, that we're always the same. You ever known anyone like that? I've known some individuals that, you know, they're always praising God. Now, maybe they're not always praising God when they're, in their private home or something all the time or whatever, but when I see them, they're praising God. They seem to be the same person. They don't seem to be up and down or tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine or whatever. They really settle down in their faith, and you can just count on it. You know, faithful people. It's so wonderful in a church to have faithful people. I've been a pastor for a long time, and I tell you, those people that are faithful in the church and the Christian life are, you know, they're so wonderful, so necessary, and so helpful in our lives. But when we're tossed to and fro, or we're here and we're there, and you can't depend on us, that is really hard. But here we say, be like me in holiness. Why? Because I'm dependable. I'm dependable. Be like me. Be dependable. Be dependable. Be faithful in your life. And then he talks about being powerful. Verse 5, you are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, it need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it be tested by fire, may be found to the praise and honor and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your soul. Of this salvation the prophets have inquired and searched carefully. He prophesied of the grace that would come to you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, who is within them, was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ by the glories that would follow. To this it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things which angels desire to look into. So the exhortation to be holy. A hard time. What's going to help us through a hard time? What's helped you in the past? What's going to help you in the future? The hard days that we have gone through and will go through in the future. Remember this, that God said, be holy as I am holy. He said so. He's got knowledge. He's smarter than we are. He's merciful. He's sure. He's powerful. And he's coming again. So we find that's the why. Well, how about the how? The how. How am I going to do this in hard times? I know why I should do it, why I should be holy, but how am I going to do that? Well, we see that goes on in 1 Peter where he says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind. So first of all, gird up the loins of your mind. Now this reference here has an idea of the robes that they wore back then. They wore robes, and when they needed to do a job or to run or to do something that took more strength than it did just going walking around in the robes, they would tie up their robes with a belt. This is the belt. Now, I don't have the robe or my coat's going to have to do. That's kind of a short one, isn't it? A short robe. But we put on a belt. And this is the best I can come up with. But that belt would tie up their robe so that they could run, so they'd be free to work around. Some of you women probably understand that better than some of us men. They'd be more free to move about, and it gave them more strength. And especially the belt. It's like a girdle. It says girdle, but a girdle. I don't know. I'll probably get in trouble here, Linda. But I don't know if girdles are popular anymore or not. But I know back when I was growing up, my mother had a girdle. I know that. And my aunt had a girdle. And they would wear those. And I remember especially my aunt that as kids were on them. You know, you wouldn't believe that. But I had an aunt named Myrtle. can't murder. And we used to look at one another and thought, this Aunt Myrtle with her girdle. And I know, you know, it was so, I don't think she ever heard us. But I identified my Aunt Myrtle with a girdle for a long time. In fact, I never thought about it till I was reading this scripture. Because actually, though, the girdle not only as a belt firms you up, this really, really helps my back, really helps me when I try to do things where I have to bend over and where I need more strength. That was the idea of this, is strength. And it's not just strength of the body, but of the mind. It says to girdle up your mind for strength. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind. And so so you need strength for your life. And you need, you're facing hard times. You've got hard times going on. So use that strength of that belt and that girding up of your mind. Have your mind be strong in the Lord and the power of His might, Peter says over in chapter 5, verse 5. I think of that a lot of times. Be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. And that's what the Christians needed. They needed to see how to understand that with this illustration of the gird up the loins of their minds. And then be sober. Here the word sober means self-control, not in hysterics, the opposite of being hysterical. Sober, self-control. Yesterday we attended a funeral. In fact, we attended two funerals this last week. Two good friends that passed on from this world into heaven. And I've been thinking quite a bit of my family. We had a daughter that died a few years ago. And we've had, of course, Lynn and I, our parents are all gone. It's like when you get up older as we are, I've said that I think I know more people in heaven than I do on earth anymore. And so it's really something to be stable and to have the strength that you need for life. And then when you're under persecution, when you're under hard times, you need that girding up, that strength to hold you and to be able to move about for God with your mind and be sober. There again, I think about being self-controlled. The fruits of the Spirit. One of the fruits is be self-controlled. To have that in your life that God supplies. And as we go back to the exhortation of holiness, that has an awful lot to do with our self-control. How we are like God. God is in control. Be sober. And then be resting fully in His grace. Rest fully in His grace. Grace of God, the favor of God, the blessing of God. Being able to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. To be able to understand that we've been called to this salvation. We've been called to this life that God has given us. Even in these hard times, Peter says. Even in these difficult times when persecution, family members and your fellow Christians are suffering in a great way, and you are suffering, or you will be to be able to have that blessing that you are called in verse 15, that as he who called you is holy, you also be holy all your life and all your conduct. So be resting fully in the grace. Relax in the Lord. Be holy. You know why it says? He's in control. Relax. Be holy means that you are turning it over to the Lord. That you're letting him take the burdens and the cares. You're letting him figure out what's going to happen tomorrow. Not that you aren't to plan and you aren't to do things, to maybe have a budget or whatever you do. But the fact of it is, not to go to the extreme like we had in our Sunday school today, where we think that we're in control, and that we can do everything ourselves. Resting fully in that favor of God, that resting, relax, believing, trusting. And then as we go on down in that passage, past that, we find here, as we trust, we find that that's worth more than anything in life, is to trust God and to follow him and to believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, and knowing we are born by the Word of God and the precious blood of Jesus, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your own conduct received by tradition from your father, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Isn't that amazing? That's not only talking about those Christians of Peter's day. That's talking for you. That's the church. For you, the body of Christ. For you, who through him believed in God and raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Since you have purified your souls and obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. God loves us. God so loved the world, so loved you. We're to love one another. Holiness brings that into you as well. It brings love. In fact, the two main, I always call the main attributes of God, the two main ones, he's got several, but the two main ones are holiness, God is holy, and God is love. That's the only two that's mentioned like that. That God is holy and that God is love. And so therefore, love one another. Love one another. Holiness will bring that to focus in our lives. And that's what they need and what we need here back in Peter's day and our day. Having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. So God's exhortation to us today, there's several through the book of Peter, 1 Peter and 2 Peter, but the one that I think would be, if there is a main one, which I think surely the holiness and the love of God, is to be holy as I am holy. He said so, and we need to pay attention to that. And we need to see that He is all knowledge. Even before the foundation of the world, He knew us. He knew us to bring us into His family as His children. He's merciful. He's sure. He's powerful. We find that He has called us to this place. Yes, hard times, but yes, we have the Lord. Gird up your loins. Be strong. Have a mind that's set on Him, a mind of Christ. Be sober, self-controlling, resting fully in the grace of the Lord. Relax in the Lord. Let Him take those great burdens and problems in your life, believing that He can bring us through it. And be using the Word of God that liveth and abideth forever, and that we find our salvation in. Dear one, today, do you have any holiness in your life? Maybe you've never really thought about that so much. I really haven't, because holiness always seemed to be so much greater than me, so much bigger. God is holy. But He says for us to be holy. And there's such benefits to that as we look at God, as we point our lives toward Him and His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit. There's such benefits in holiness. So when we sing that holy, 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 then we realize that that is God Almighty, but He wants us to be holy so that we can have that likeness of Him Himself in our lives that will carry us through the hard times, the difficult times. Some of you know that. He's brought you through so much. Some of you will have yet got to face to think about God is holy. And He's with you. He's going to help you. Even if you're persecuted, even if you're not understood, even no matter what happens in your life, He cares. He's called us in praise and glory in His eyes. Okay. Heavenly Father, thank You for this wonderful exhortation today to be holy. And Lord, this world is not holy. Lord, this world is very sinful. This world is very, very cruel in so many ways. But Lord, You're not like that. You are merciful, graceful, loving. You are holy. And we thank You, Lord, You've given us that exhortation to be like You. And we know that we can only do that coming through Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and finding that salvation through that shed blood there on the cross, to forgive our sins and to cleanse us and to raise us up into that living hope and that living, blessed resurrection that Jesus has done for us, and that we can claim in our lives yet future. So thank You again, Lord, for this congregation. We do pray for the pastor and people that are away today, that You would give them special grace and mercy and help. And thank You again, in Jesus' name. Amen.